Well, good morning, and we'd like to welcome you to ICS 100 training today. I'm Yvette Johnson Walker from the University of Illinois Center for One Health, and we're here with our team of trainers who are going to talk to you about ICS 100 and its role in preparing people involved in animal emergency and rescue, and how we can use the tools in ICS to effectively support emergency response and rescue sessions. And so our first speaker here is Mr. Keith Guerin, and he's going to get us started this morning. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you. Okay, today what we're going to cover is the Incident Command Basic Introductory Class, the ICS 100. It's all part of the FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency training curriculum. The program today we're actually designed to give you all the tools so that you can go online and take the test and become certified in ICS 100. What's really nice about it, though, is that no matter where you go in the United States, that certification counts. So it works out very well. So let's go ahead and get started here today once I get everything turned on. It's based on the ICS 100, and what we've done, we've adapted it to the animal care community, animal rescue community. We're going to do the presentation today, we're going to take a couple of breaks, and then we're actually going to come back and do some examples and show you where you'll fit directly into an emergency response situation in your community. An overview of ICS, there's three objectives we're going to do today. First of all, there's three purposes of incident command system. We're going to explain what they are, and the requirements on when you use them. We're going to start with a little video.
Disaster can strike anytime, anywhere. It takes many forms: a hurricane, an earthquake, a tornado, a flood, a fire, or a hazardous spill, or an act of terrorism. An incident can build over days or weeks, or hit suddenly, without warning. A poorly managed incident response can undermine our safety and well-being. With so much at stake, we must effectively manage our response efforts. Although most incidents are handled locally, partnerships among local, tribal, state, and federal agencies, as well as non-governmental and private sector organizations, may be required. As partners, we must respond together in a seamless, coordinated fashion. The Incident Command System, or ICS, helps ensure integration of our response efforts. ICS is a standardized, on-scene, all-hazards approach to incident management. ICS allows all responders to adopt an integrated organizational structure that matches the complexities and demands of the incident, while respecting agency and jurisdictional authorities. Although ICS promotes standardization, it is not without needed flexibility. For example, the ICS organizational structure can expand or contract to meet incident needs. In this course, you'll learn ICS principles, and more importantly, you'll learn to interface better with your response partners.
Okay, now we're fairly certain that you're probably not going to be managing the entire response yourself. You have local, county, state emergency management folks who actually do that for you. But what's important, though, is that how do you plug into that larger response? As we've seen from incidents like in Katrina and Rita and things like that, there's a very large component dealing with animal rescue and protecting animals and things like that. And that's where ICS fits in. How do you fit into the larger scheme? What is ICS? It's standardized. It works for everything. It can be a Katrina, Rita type thing. It can be a local event. If you have a large event party or something like that going on, some sort of event in your community, can go into it. But what's really nice, it is a coordinated response among everybody that has responsibility there. And it's a management system. ICS is a way to manage large number of people and resources. So it's a larger process, but you only activate the parts of it that you need. If you don't need parts of it, leave it alone. You don't have to start over. But it's standardized and it's coordinated. and it involves everybody that's part of the process. So if you're working with your local and county emergency management agencies, you know where they plug in, they know where you plug in, and things like that. It's a common process for planning management of resources, people, equipment. How do you control all that? Do you have the right equipment for the right needs and things like that? But it's a coordinated response. And how does that work in larger incidents? How does that actually work for animal rescue and animal protection? How do you make sure you have the right equipment, the right people at the right place at the right time? Well, because you plug into the incident command system, and then you work collectively with local and county emergency management. And it's integration with a common organizational structure. You plug into local emergency management. Everything we talk about today, you just have to have your organizations prepared. You don't necessarily have to do everything else. Your local police, fire, emergency management, emergency medical services, they will have their resources already prepared. They have the same training that you're getting today. And then you all work together collectively in this coordinated response. But everybody works together with that common organizational structure, so you're not duplicating resources and things like that. IGMEs for natural hazards. We don't have a lot of hurricanes up here. We have tornadoes, large fires, you know, things like that. There's all kinds of different hazards you can get up there. Technological hazards, human-caused hazards, mass shootings, explosions, and things like that. And for planned events, like up here in Chicago, they've got all these large planned events. I assure you they use incident command system when they're setting those up and how they coordinate them. An incident is an occurrence or event, natural or human cause, that requires a response to protect life or property. That's what we're talking about an incident or an event. It's all the same thing. It's a plan or it's something that happens, and it's how do you respond to it. Human cause requires a response to protect life or property. That's what it's all about. That's where you coordinate all your resources, make everything work together. Why use ICS? ICS has been around for a long time. What they have found is that when they started using this back in the 1960s out the wildland fires out in California, it works really, really well. It's based on a military model, organizational structure, and things like that. It works very well. The other thing is it's mandated by the federal government. All local agencies, all county, all state, they're supposed to be compliant with what's called the National Incident Management System. That compliance is required if you want federal funding and things like that. And it mandates, as part of the National Incident Management System, the use of the Incident Command System, both for emergencies, disasters, and for pre-planned events, the institutionalization of the Incident Command System. What are we talking about with NIMS? It's a consistent nationwide template. The National Incident Management System is a way that the federal government, after 9/11, can say, okay, we need a process throughout the entire nation that everybody's going to respond to in the same way. So it's a consistent nationwide template, but it enables all these agencies to work together, the federal, state, tribal, local governments, private sector, non-governmental organizations to work together. Why? Because you have a common operating picture. Shared resources, co-located facilities, you have a common operating structure. Everybody plugs into the same process. That's why it works. And how? To prepare for pre-planning, prevent, respond to, recover from, and mitigate the effects of incidents regardless of cause, size, location, or complexity. Doesn't matter. ICS expands or contracts based on the need of the event. If it's a small event, you may have just an incident commander. That may be the only position you have to fill. All ICS structures, that's the first position you fill. That's one that's required in all responses. But after that, the different positions you learn about later today, you may not need them. But that's why there's flexibility. You expand or contract based on the needs of the operation, and you use the resources to maximum efficiency. And why? In order to reduce the loss of life, property, and harm to the environment. Because it works. You share your resources, you work on a common operating picture, and it works very well to coordinate that. That's why it works so well. National Wildland Fires uses it every year. Fire service uses a lot. It works very, very well to do all that. These are the five components of the National Incident Management System: preparedness, communications, information management, resource management, ongoing maintenance, and management. But this is what we're talking about here today: command and management, specifically incident command system. Now, beyond this, if you find this is really interesting, you want to go beyond it. Beyond it, you can get the multi-agency coordination systems. And that's where you have large events, where you have city, county, all working together for very, very large events to respond to different incidents and events. And then ultimately public information, because the public has a critical role. In your situation, You want the public to know how to care for their animals. You want the public to know where to take animals or where to come find their animals at. Public information is a way to deal with that because that's the information flow to the rest of the public. So all this works together in the command and management, which is one of five components of the National Incident Management System. We're only going to talk about the incident command system today. Now, if it makes you feel any better, there are other classes available. Some of them you can take online. Some you have to be actually in a classroom to do it. There's all kinds available. What have we learned about? Without ICS, it just falls apart fast. Because think about it. You have a large-scale incident, and just everybody shows up, does whatever they want. Agency A says, we're going to do this. Agency B says, we're going to do this. Agency C says, we don't care what you guys are doing. We're going to do all this. Now, do you think that's very efficient? Agency A says, we need 15 widgets. Agency B says, we need 23 widgets. Agency C says, we need 400 widgets. Well, how are you going to do that? They're going to order from different areas and things like that. It doesn't work real well. You have to have some sort of accountability. You have to work together. Poor accountability. How do you count for people? How do you count for resources? How do you make sure jobs are getting done? How do you take care of all that? Without ICS, you have poor communications. Think about that. Agency A, B, and C are doing whatever they want. Do you think they're going to talk to each other? Nah, of course not. They're not, but there's poor communication. What is the one thing that everybody always complains about in large-scale events? Yeah, see, you figured that out. Yeah, it's communication. And it's not always the hardware. It's sometimes people just don't think about it, they don't get the right information out in the right conduits, and it doesn't get out very well. But poor communication is always a problem. How about if your planning process has no systematic method to it? If you have a plan, don't y'all want to plan the same way? Don't you want to be working on the same plan? Because if you just show up in an emergency and say, okay, we're going to take all your animals. Well, first of all, you're really going to like wind up a bunch of people because you're not taking my animals anywhere, right? They get a little touchy about that. But the thing is, you say, hey, we have a place for you to place your animals. That's a different story because there's historical fact that actually says a lot of people won't leave their homes if they don't have a place for animals. And a lot of shelters, like the Red Cross sets up and things like that, they will not take domestic animals. So there has to be a mechanism in place. And how do you do that? Easily. You work with the people who are setting up the shelters. You work with the people who are getting out the public information. But if you don't have this systematic planning process, you're not part of the process. And people will not know what's available. It's just like you're advertising every day. What advertising do you do to get the public to know what's going on? You want to involve the public, get that information out. Well, you need to get that same information out to your local emergency management, your local police, fire, and EMA, emergency management, because then they know what resources you bring to the table. Because do you think the Cook County Emergency Management or Chicago OEMC, do you think they have just unlimited resources of ways to take care of small domestic animals like cages and food and people to take care of them? Probably doesn't happen. They have to reach out to organizations to do it, and that's where you all come in. So you have to have something systematic, and they find without ICS, it's very unsystematic. Everybody just does what they want. It gets all, you know, screwed up. And they're not able to efficiently integrate responders. Think about that. You've got, you know, some happens, you know, knock on wood, God forbid, some happens in the city of Chicago. There's a lot of animals out there. Well, how are you going to deal with those animals? If you can plug right in to the fire department, to OEMC, to the state, to the county. If you can plug right into that, can you then deliver your services to the people who need those services quickly? Yeah, because local emergency management, local responders know what resources you're bringing to the table. Why? Because it's pre-planned. It's all there. But without ICS, all this falls apart, and that's where it becomes problematic. So the secret is you need to have your act together and be sure that you're connected to local and county emergency management, and that's how it all works together. Why? Safety of responders and workers. Number one is always safety. Second, achievement of response objectives. What would your response objective be? In a large-scale incident, what is your objective? What do you want to do? Yes, rescue the animals. Give them a place to take animals that need shelter. Give people the peace to have their animals somewhere that's safe. Maybe they'll stay with them, maybe they won't. But safety of responders and workers is first. So if you're not safe, you want to be sure you're in a safe area, that you have all the equipment you need, and you be sure you have parameters. Will you take snakes? Okay, I see by the look on your face, you won't. I'm right there with you on that one. I wouldn't do it either. But the thing is, do you want snakes with a bunch of dogs and cats? I don't know. But you have to ask the experts who do. But the thing is, you want to coordinate those responses. But you want to be safe. Achievement of response objectives. That's one of the benefits, because everybody knows what your objectives are. You have taken your objectives to the table, and you've told local agencies what your objectives are. Protect the animals. Find homes for animals, things like that. That's what your objectives are. You go to the table and you say, these are our objectives. This is what we bring to the table. We bring the expertise. We bring the equipment. We bring people who will help care for the animals, shelters and things like that. That's what you bring to the table. Why? Because nobody has unlimited resources. And it's efficient use of resources. So that you're not duplicating, you know, what's already in process. So, couple things to remember should you decide to take the written exam at a later point. ICS is a standardized management tool for meeting the demands of smaller or large emergency and non-emergency situations. Remember, it expands or contracts based on the need of the operation. Represents the best practices. Why? Because it actually works really, really well. When done properly, when institutionalized within the organization, it works really, really well. It's nationwide. Homeland Security Presidential Directive number 5 says, thou shalt do this way in domestic incidents. National Incident Management System is that. You know, ICS is part of the NIMS outline. And it can be used for planned events, natural disaster, acts of terrorism. Think about that. If you are from like a city like Chicago or any large metropolitan area, what you find is there's large events, and you may have a need to have animals somewhere. You may have a need in emergencies to have animals placed somewhere. So it can be used for planned events, natural disaster, acts of terrorism, whatever the need. Doesn't matter. Remember, it's all hazard. That's the secret here. It's an all hazard response. Doesn't matter why you need to have animals in shelters. Doesn't matter why you need to take care of them. The fact is, you have the mechanism to shelter, to care for the animals. You have the expertise, the equipment, the facilities to do that. And that's what you bring to the table. Local emergency management, local police, fire, and EMS need those resources. And later today you'll see some examples, and we hope that will identify exactly what a critical role that does play. And we've already talked about it's a key feature in the National Incident Management System. Questions for me?
Is hoarding listed
under? Is what?
Hoarding.
Hoarding? Listed under a disaster? I mean, hoarding is an individual characteristic that people use. Well, if they have like animals and things like that, ICS could be used for that. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. If they have somebody who has like stored a bunch of animals that can't care for them, do you have a plan? Have you worked with local health department? Have you worked with local police, with local fire? Do you have the resources you need if somebody has 15 dogs and 6 cats or something like that? Do you have cages for them? Do you have people that can go out and take care of them? Have you got something in place with your local animal management? And that could be a pre-planned event. Doesn't matter where, doesn't matter why. You have X number of animals that need care, that need shelter, need veterinary care and things like that. Is it pre-planned? Have you worked with your local emergency management, local police, local fire, local public health perhaps, and said, hey, if you have this incident, this is what our organization brings. We have the cages, we have the people, we're glad to do it. It's pre-planned. And then in the meantime, you know what your resources are. And then as you work with the county, you say, well, if we ever have a hoarding incident where they have more than, just as an example, 15 dogs, we don't have enough cages for that. Well, then you might reach out to a neighboring community and see what their animal control or their animal welfare agencies have. And then maybe you would call them, and or maybe they would say, hey, in future years, we're going to plan our budget. In our budget, we're going to add so many cages a year. Maybe we want to stockpile food and share it, your emergency stockpile, rotate that in with your local humane society or something like that that's storing the animals for, you know, for whatever reason. So yes, it can. That's the long way to say yes. But yes, but those are examples how that could be used, but it's pre-planned. As you go farther up in the incident command, you'll hear about something called an incident action plan, and we'll just touch on them later today. That's one of the things that would be perfect for what we call an IAP, or an incident action plan. because it lists who you're going to contact, lists the resource you have, lists what everybody's going to do. And then when you get the call at 3 o'clock in the morning or whatever, and they say, hey, we have this situation where somebody is hoarding all these animals, then you can do that. Now, then you can also work for the larger animals, you know, like horses or, you know, cows, pigs, whatever they have. And then you maybe reach out to other local, so whatever resources you have. So, yeah, most definitely. Excellent. Yes, ma'am.
What do you mean exactly by plug in, especially in practice, to the different local organizations?
You work together. The local organizations, all cities and counties have been working, and states, have been working on compliance with the National Incident Management System for years. What you want to do, you want to be part of that process. Because that's what's nice about this, you pre-plan a lot of that. So when I say plug in, it means just go work with them. And you can reach out to them. They may not know about your organization. You call your local county emergency management, unless you're in the city of Chicago, then it'd be OEMC. And they say, hey, this is what my organization brings to the table. Now they may have things in place that you could assist with. They may have another animal, you know, welfare, animal protection, animal rescue organization already is the lead in that area. And you would just become part of that response. So when I say plug in, it just means be part of what they're doing and part of the response and part of the resources they'll be able to bring to the table for something that happens, whether it's a hoarding incident or a disaster or a large fire or something like that. So you can work seamlessly with them. Excellent. Those are my little words. Other questions? Okay. Want to take a little break? Let's take about a 5-minute break so we can switch around microphones and do all that stuff. Okay? That means we're done.